Okay, dear students, welcome you all for today's class 10 science class. In our last class, actually we were discussing about specific heat capacity. Specific heat capacity, we were discussing about this, and today I have got one message. The student has asked me to just make it clear once, sir. In message it has come like that. That's why I will just make it clear. It's very simple. What is the specific heat capacity? Actually, the amount of heat required, okay, to increase the temperature 1 kg mass of the body by 1 degree centigrade is called its specific heat capacity. It's clear? Specific heat capacity of a substance of a body is defined as the amount of heat required to increase 1 kg mass of its substance by 1 degree centigrade. Clear? Suppose this is a body and its mass is 1 kg and it has got some temperature right now. To increase that temperature by 1 degree centigrade, suppose it is in 15 degree centigrade, 1 kg mass, but you have to be very much careful regarding mass for 1 kg mass. Okay? If you have to increase its temperature by 1 degree centigrade, suppose it is now at 15 degree centigrade, so now from 15 degree centigrade to 16 degree centigrade, increase is 1 degree centigrade. How much heat is required? Suppose, let us suppose 400 joules. This is a body A, and if its mass is 1 kg, to increase its temperature by 1 degree centigrade, if suppose 400 joules of heat energy is required, then the specific heat capacity of A, we can say 400 joules per kg degree centigrade. Now I think it's clear. Suppose if the mass is more, if you are talking about 5 kg mass and to increase its temperature by 1 degree centigrade, suppose 2000 joules of heat energy is required, then you cannot say 2000 joules per kg degree centigrade because the mass is 5 kg here. So you have to calculate then, if to increase the temperature by 1 degree centigrade of mass 5 kg, if 2000 joule is needed, then how much joule of heat energy is required for 1 kg mass to increase its temperature by 1 degree centigrade? That will be the specific heat capacity. Clear? You have to be very much careful for that. Now, another regarding specific heat capacity, one more thing I would like to make you clear. Suppose this is a body A and this is another body B, suppose B, and A, body B, both have got suppose same mass, suppose 1 kg. Simple to understand, 1 kg. B also has got mass 1 kg. Okay? Now both A and B are at temperature suppose 20 degree centigrade. B also at 20 degree centigrade. Up to here you try to understand. Body A, its mass 1 kg, it is at 20 degree centigrade. Body B, mass also 1 kg, it is also at 20 degree centigrade. Now, if suppose specific heat capacity, specific heat capacity of A is suppose 500, that means 500 joules per kg degree centigrade, and that of B is suppose 400 joules per kg degree centigrade. Try to understand. As because the question is the request has come, okay, through the message to make it clear. That's why I'm taking time. Okay, those who have understood, it's very very fine, very good. But for those, if it's not clear, please be serious and try to understand. Suppose there are two bodies A and B. Their masses are 1 kg each one's mass is 1 kg. And both A and B, they are at the same temperature, 20 degree centigrade. Specific heat capacity of A is suppose 500 joules per kg degree centigrade, and that of B is 400 joules per kg degree centigrade. Now, the temperature has to be raised from 20 to 21 for both the bodies. That means A, the temperature of A also we have to make it 21 degree centigrade. And that of B also we have to make it suppose 21 degree centigrade. It means what? For both A and B, now we have to raise their temperature by 1 degree centigrade. If you will see, from 20 to 21 means what? How much increment? How much raise? 1 degree. Clear? 1 degree centigrade. So, if I ask you now simply by looking here, you have to reply. If I ask you, how much heat A will require and how much heat B will require to reach from 20 to 21, very easily you can answer by looking their specific heat capacity. Look here, 500 joules per kg degree centigrade means what? It means A requires 500 joules of heat energy for its 1 kg mass to let its temperature increase by 1 degree centigrade. Okay. Similarly, B needs 400 joules. It means in this scenario, in this case, in this condition, 1 kg mass, 1 kg mass, increment 1 degree centigrade, 1 degree centigrade, A requires 500 joules of heat, whereas B requires 400 joules of heat. This much is clear. Now, if you are asked who will reach first at 21 degree centigrade, who will gain this, obtain this temperature 21 degree centigrade first, A or B? Again, you think A needs 500 joules, B needs 400 joules. So, definitely B will reach first at 21, because by absorbing 400 joules only, this 1 kg mass of B will reach from 21, whereas A needs 500 joules. So, that is why A will get heated faster. So, what is the conclusion we are getting here? The body who has got less specific heat capacity will get heated faster. Clear? Now, just vice versa, just reverse of this, try to understand. So, suppose from 20 to 21, how much heat A has gained? 500 joules. So, A has gained 500 joules, then only A has reached up to 21. From 20 to 21, how much heat B has gained? 400 joules. Now, I am asking you reverse case. You just now imagine, okay, both A and B are at now 21 degree centigrade, and they have to now come at 20 degree centigrade. That means their temperature has to be decreased. It means we are cooling them, we are going to cool them. Okay. So, who, again the same question, who will come at 20 degree centigrade temperature faster, A or B? You can understand, while going from 20 to 21, A has absorbed 500 joules, then only A has reached up to 21, whereas B has absorbed 400 joules. Now, on cooling, reverse case, okay, coming back from 21 to 20, how much heat A has to lose? Now, think, A has to lose 500 joules. Then only A will come from 21 to 20, and B has to lose 400 joules of heat energy to come back from 21 to 20. So B has to lose less. So that's why B will come at 20 degree centigrade faster rather than A. So in this case also, what we find, what's the conclusion we are getting, that the one who has got less specific heat capacity gets cooled faster. Vice versa, reverse case, the one who has got more specific heat capacity gets cooled late. Okay, clear? In Nepali, if I say jun vastu ko स्पेसिफिक हिट कैपेसिटी बड़ी त्यो ढिलो तातिन्छ र ढिलो चीसो हुन्छ, जुन सब्सटेंस को स्पेसिफिक हिट कैपेसिटी कम हुन्छ त्यो छिटो तातिन्छ र छिटो कूल हुन्छ। दैट्स वाई इन माई लास्ट क्लास आई हैड टोल्ड यू, आई मीन रिगार्डिंग वाटर, वाटर हैज गॉट अ वेरी हाई स्पेसिफिक हिट कैपेसिटी। हाउ मच यू नो? या 4200 जूल्स पर केजी डिग्री सेंटीग्रेड। So it's a very, very big number, as because water has got a very high specific heat capacity, that's why water gets heated, later, it takes more time to get heated. And similarly, it takes more time, once it gets heated, once it becomes hot, now the hot water takes more time to get cooled. Okay, cold water takes more time to get hot, and hot water takes more time to get cool, because specific heat capacity of water is high. It's clear? So I'm sure now specific heat capacity, the concept of specific heat capacity is clear. Now let's come here with the another term, that is your thermal capacity. That is your thermal capacity. What is the thermal capacity? In short, I have written in a simple way, the thermal capacity of a body is defined as the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of the body by 1 degree centigrade. Students get confused sometimes with these two terms. The first term, which already we have come to know, that is your specific heat capacity, and this term, your thermal capacity. Thermal capacity and specific heat, what is the difference? Regarding mass, there is difference. If you think about the definition of specific heat capacity, what is specific heat capacity? Specific heat capacity of a body is defined as the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of 1 kg mass of the body by 1 degree centigrade. If you see here, specific heat capacity, what is the specific heat capacity? The specific heat capacity of a body is defined as the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of 1 kg mass of the body by 1 degree centigrade. But here in thermal capacity, the thermal capacity of a body is defined as the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of the whole body, not 1 kg mass, by 1 degree centigrade. Suppose this is a body and its mass is m, and it suppose its specific heat capacity is s. So what is S? By definition, you try to understand what is S. The heat required, okay, heat required to increase 1 kg mass of the substance by 1 degree centigrade, okay. So for 1 kg mass, what is the heat required? That is your S. That is your specific heat capacity. So for m mass, for 1 kg mass, S amount of heat is required, because by definition we are understanding that specific heat capacity is the amount of heat required to increase the temperature of 1 kg mass of substance by 1 degree centigrade. That is called specific heat capacity. So S is that, okay, specific heat capacity. If the mass is m, then what will be the heat required for the total body? M into S. For unit mass, S. For the mass m, you have to multiply m into S. So that's why I have written here mathematically C. That means thermal capacity. Thermal capacity is equals to mass into specific heat capacity. This is clear. What is thermal capacity? So if the mass of a body is given, and if its specific heat capacity is given, then very easily we can calculate what will be the thermal capacity. Okay. Now let's go. What is heat equation? So till today in this chapter, we have come to know that actually heat flows from a body at higher temperature towards a body at lower temperature. So there is either loss in heat, okay, or there is gain in heat. Some object may lose and some object may gain heat. So actually, what is the heat equation? Whenever there is either heat loss or heat gain, that will be equals to, okay, heat gain or heat lost by a body. if if we go out around 12-1 o'clock, what we feel actually, okay, if we go out in the sun, so what we'll feel hot. Why? Because we are gaining heat from the atmosphere, because the atmospheric temperature is higher than our body temperature. So that's why our body will gain heat from the atmosphere. So that's why we feel hot, okay. And after roaming for few minutes, few hours outside, and when we come inside the room, that time what happens? We feel cool, because our body temperature is more, whereas the room temperature is less, okay. So that's why what happens, the heat will come out. That means we will lose heat. So a body either loses heat or the body gains heat according to the circumstances, okay. But how much heat the body loses or how much heat the body gains, that can be calculated by heat equation, okay. So the amount of heat lost by your body or the amount of heat gained by your body is given by the equation that is called heat equation, and that is written like this: Q equals to m into S into dT. Now question arises, what is Q? We have come to know this is your heat lost or heat gain, that Q. And what is m? M is the mass of the body, okay. M is mass of the body. So how much a body loses heat or how much a body gains heat, it depends on the mass also. And what is S? Specific heat capacity. specific heat capacity. And what is dT? This is the temperature difference. Temperature difference. Actually, how this equation has come? How this heat equation has come? I think one demonstration I had explained 2 days back. Once again, I will just make you understand that. Suppose this is a container A, this is another container B, suppose, and both have got water. Look here. And both are at 20 degree centigrade temperature, suppose 20 degree centigrade. Now, if you are asked, you are going to heat, suppose, and if suppose now you will make temperature now 21 degree centigrade, that means the temperature of water in this container also has to reach up to 21, and this also 21. Now, simply look here, to which container we have to give more heat. That means A or B will gain more heat. In both the cases, they have to gain it because they have to increase their temperature. Okay? Who will gain more heat? Who will gain more heat? Q. Definitely, if you see here, A, because the mass of A is more than mass of B. Clear? If you are going to suppose boil 10 kg mass water and 5 kg mass water, definitely you have to supply more heat for 10 kg mass. So, heat required will be more. So, that means heat gained by 10 kg mass water will be more. So, that means what? Q is directly proportional to the mass of the body. You can very easily understand. Okay? Similarly, in this case, actually, in this case, what I had done, here is the temperature difference 1 degree centigrade, here also temperature difference 1 degree centigrade. That means I had kept dT, I had kept constant. So, when the temperature difference for two bodies of the same substance, okay, that is constant, then the amount of heat gained or lost is directly proportional to the mass of the body. This is clear. Now, this is one case we have come to know heat gained or heat loss that is directly proportional to the mass of the body. Suppose this is another case. Here is the water, suppose it is at 20 degree centigrade. Okay? Now, to make the temperature from 20 to 21, you have to supply some heat. Okay? You have to supply some heat. If you have to make the temperature from 21 to 25, then with the same supply of heat, you can reach there. No. You have to add more heat. That means you have to supply more heat. Here, look here. Here, mass we have kept constant. We are not going to change the mass. But what we are getting here, the change. Suppose this is your 1 degree centigrade change in temperature or difference, temperature difference. Here, suppose 21 to 25, 4 degree centigrade temperature difference. So, for 1 degree centigrade, how much heat you have to supply? For 2 degree centigrade difference, or for 3 degree centigrade difference, more amount of heat you have to supply. That means heat lost or heat gain, that is also directly proportional to the dT. dT is the temperature difference. Temperature difference means the difference between final and the initial temperature. Okay? Clear? In this case, we are keeping m constant. M is constant. In this case, dT, temperature difference, is constant. This is formula second. So in this way, actually we find that heat lost or heat gained by a body is directly proportional to the mass of the body, and it is also directly proportional to the temperature difference. Clear? Understood? So by joint variation, you can write, for by joint variation, what you find here, Q proportion m into dT. If you want to convert this into the sign of equality, Q equals to, we have to write one constant. That constant is S, m dT. This S is the constant known as specific heat capacity. This is specific heat capacity, and we can write it like this also, Q equals to m into S dT. So this is your heat equation, heat gain or heat loss by body equals to Q, body Q equals to m into S into dT. How that equation, how this equation, how this formula has come, I have already explained you. Heat loss or heat gain by a body is directly proportional to the mass of the body if the temperature difference is constant. Okay, keeping temperature difference constant, heat loss or heat gain by a body is directly proportional to the temperature difference, keeping the mass of the body constant. By joint variation, we can write Q equals proportion m into dT. To change into equality, we have to put one constant of proportionality. So S is that constant of proportionality, that is called specific heat capacity. So in that way, this formula we have obtained, Q equals to m into S into dT. Clear? So heat equation is clear. Now next topic is your principle of calorimetry. What does it say? Look here, whenever two bodies at different temperatures come in contact, heat loss by body at higher temperature is equal to heat gain by body at lower temperature. Definitely one condition is there, I mean some heat might be lost in the atmosphere, but that is neglected here. Okay, in that condition, so what does it mean? Suppose this is a body A, this is another body B, this is another body B, and suppose A is at a temperature, mass of the A is suppose m1, and its specific heat capacity is S1, and mass of body B is m2, and its specific heat capacity is S2. Suppose the temperature of A is T1 and temperature of B is T2, and condition is your T1 is greater than T2. Now you think what will happen if they come in thermal contact. If the both the bodies are brought in thermal contact, A and B, there are different temperature, T1 greater than T2. So that means A is at higher temperature than B. What will happen? We all know there will be flow of heat. I mean, you just try to think the very first day when we had started this topic, heat and temperature. Okay, and we had. Analogously, we had compared this with the flow of water from higher level to the lower level, like this. If you remember, I am just showing you. this is the level of water here, and here is the level of water. So if this container has water up to this level, it has got water up to this level, and both these containers are connected. The flow of water from the water at higher level to the water at lower level, and it will keep on going till they attain the same level. Clear? Now the flow of water stops. Same thing happens with the two bodies at the thermal contact. Whenever two bodies come at thermal contact, then the heat will start flowing from the body at higher temperature towards the body at the lower temperature. So here there will be flow of heat from A to B. Why? Because A is at higher temperature. Now the question arises, how long this flow of heat keeps on going until they attain the same temperature? That means final temperature should be same like this, and this flow of water will keep on going until they reach the same level. Similarly, when two bodies at different thermal at different temperature they come at thermal contact, then from the body at higher temperature it will start flowing towards the body at lower temperature, and it will keep on going till they will attain the same temperature. So suppose that same temperature, so heat is flowing from A to B. Because A is at higher temperature, B is at lower temperature, so there will keep flow of heat from A to B until they attain the same temperature. Final temperature becomes same. Suppose that is T. Let us suppose that is T. So A also attains temperature T, B also attains temperature T. That becomes same. Now the flow of heat stops. Okay. Now what the principle of calorimetry say? That heat lost by body at higher temperature, that means heat lost by A, that will be equals to heat gain. That heat, who will gain? B will gain. Heat gain, heat lost is equals to heat gain by body B, which is at lower temperature. And yes, of course, you should always keep in your mind here the heat lost in the atmosphere is neglected, okay, because some of the heat is being lost in the atmosphere also, but that is neglected. Clear? That is not considered. So in that case, heat lost by the body at higher temperature will be heat will be equals to heat gain by the body at lower temperature. Now what will be the mathematical value? To get this mathematical value, we have to go back in the heat equation. In the heat equation, we have come to know the formula that heat gained or heat lost by a body equals to Q into M, Q equals to M into S into dT. So M S dT. So heat lost by A, M, what is the M of A? M1. Okay. Yes, S of A, S1. Now dT. dT is what? Temperature difference. So that will be how much? Try to understand here. Suppose that is temperature difference is for body A is dT1, and heat gain by the body at lower temperature same MSdT. So M2 mass, S is S2, and suppose temperature difference dT2. You have to understand this, how much will be dT1 and dT2. Very simple. M1 is clear, S1 is clear, dT1, that is the temperature difference. Initially A was at temperature T1. Now A is losing heat because there is flow of heat from A to B. That means the temperature of A is going down, and ultimately the final temperature is becoming T. It means temperature difference for A is T1 minus T. Suppose it was initially at 30 degree centigrade and finally the temperature has become 25 degree centigrade. Then what is the temperature difference? 30 minus 25. That means T1 minus T. So this dT1 means T1 minus T. where T1 is the initial temperature of A, T is the final temperature. Similarly, and this will be equals to M2 is clear, S2 is clear. Now, what is D2? So, D2 means temperature difference for body B. Initially, the body was at temperature T2, but finally, its temperature has become T. Suppose initially it was 30 degree centigrade and it was at suppose at 23 degree centigrade. Okay, it was at 30 degree centigrade, it was at 23 degree centigrade. Now the final temperature has become 25. So what will be the temperature difference for B? 25 minus 23. So B is gaining heat, it means the temperature of B is rising. It means what? T is greater than T2. So, this difference will come when we subtract T2 from T. So, dT2 is your T minus T2. Whenever the body at higher temperature is losing heat, it means its temperature is going down. Okay, it's decreasing. That's why temperature difference T1 minus T. And the one who was initially at the lower temperature B, that body was gaining heat, that means its temperature is rising, that means final temperature is more than its initial temperature. That's why for this body temperature difference will be T minus T2. So this is the ultimate equation which we are getting from the principle of calorimetry. Clear? Okay. The bell has gone for today, so that's why for today this much only. Thank you very much.